Hey everybody, I'm Tom Barnes. This is the Stories from the 78, which we can do anywhere in the world. And we're doing that today because we have Marshall Julius from London. I have Howard Berger here joining us from California, and I'm here in Chicago. So we're kind of just doing this whole thing live via satellite. And gentlemen, thank you for joining me. I really appreciate it and love this book that you have put out there, Masters of Makeup Effects, which I feel like is like the Bible of special effects, horror films, and monsters. So I'll let you guys take it from there, but thank you for joining me.
Yeah, no, thank you so much. And I think we like that term Bible, so that's very nice. I mean, you know, there was a book that I loved when I was a kid, which is called Making a Monster, that Sue Roy and Al Taylor had written in the like 80 or 81. And that was my Bible. And that was really the leaping off point for this book, because I always felt like there should be a sequel to that book, another volume to that book. There never was. And so when the opportunity arose, Marshall and I decided that would be kind of like, you know, the springboard of how this book would be, you know, put together and come about and represent. So yes, I love that people are using the word makeup effects Bible, which is super cool because it is unlike anything else. You know, we didn't want to do a book that was about myself or K&B, which is the effects company I own with Greg Nicotero, or do chapters on individual makeup people, but we wanted to like kind of spread the wealth throughout the book with all these different people. Marshall and I interviewed 67 people in the film business, being makeup effects artists, directors, actors, VFX supervisors, editors, and that way we could get like a wider net of you know, what we do and how it works in the different people's, you know, careers and crafts, you know. So yeah, it's really super fun, and it's the book I always wanted to own. And so, you know, sometimes, you know, like there's filmmakers like Quentin Tarantino who makes movies, the movies he makes are the films he always wanted to see. So this is a book that I always wanted to read. So we thought, okay, let's go ahead and write this book. Right, Marshall?
Yeah, absolutely. I like the word Bible because it does have a slightly, well, obviously it has a sort of religious connotation, but it reminds me of when my mom used to say to me that everywhere you go, if you wear a Star of David and you bump into another Jew, my mom was sort of traditional Jewish rather than actually sort of religious, but she would say, wherever you go in the world, you meet someone, then you've got that sort of instant sort of kinship with them. And I know what she means, but to be honest, wherever I go in the world, if they're wearing a Universal Monsters t-shirt or a Star Wars t-shirt, then I feel like I have that kinship with them. So that is sort of like my chosen religion, movies and monsters. And so, yeah, it does feel like we kind of put together a Bible with a lot of help from a lot of amazingly talented people. So it's turned out. It's turned out pretty well. I've never worked on anything where we, you know, the discussions that Howard and I had at the very beginning and our sort of hopes for the book actually turned out to, you know, kind of to happen. We've had reviews of the book that it was almost like people were listening in on us in those early conversations because, you know, that's exactly. So basically this is me patting myself on the back saying, yeah, we created a really bloody good book, actually. Yeah.
Yes, you did. I could attest to that just as a watching the pages as I'm flipping through them and reading them. I am too one of, I don't know if you can see my shirt here, but I'm wearing a Monster Squad t-shirt. And I saw one of the articles about the gentleman that created the Creature from the Black Lagoon in there. And you have some of my favorites, you know, like Robert Englund's in there talking about all the makeup. And I really feel like this book is a validation for people like me and you, where it's like, these are my people. They totally get it. Like my house right now is like a horror movie haunted house set for Halloween. It's scaring the hell out of my neighbors, and I love it. We built like a graveyard out front. So like to be able to flip through the pages and really listen to the people who made these moments happen, that's incredible. You know, just interviewing all those people had to be a lot of fun just to hear their own accounts of these movies. Some of these movies are like the all-time classics, you know, from like the 1920s. and then stuff that Howard, you've worked on. That's got to be a lot of fun just to go back and do that. And this all happened because of the pandemic. You guys were like, "Yeah, hey, we got something to do because everybody's at home in this lockdown," right?
Yeah, pretty much. I mean, Marshall and I met in 2006, and Marshall has been asking about writing a book since then. And so I didn't have an excuse this time to not write the book when the pandemic hit. So right away, you know, I mean, we shut down in March 13th, and literally by April 1st, we were already talking about the book and came up with the format quickly. And then we just started interviewing people. I reached out to everyone I know, and we were very lucky that everybody agreed to do it, give 2 hours of their day to us interviewing them. And it was really fun. And similar to this, it was just kind of like we set it up as we're just going to have a conversation and talk. And, you know, one answer will open up like 10 new questions. So
sure,
we just kept going and going. And, you know, like I said, it was about 2 hours for everybody. And some people wanted to talk longer, which was great. And we went from there. And once we had everything written, you know, Marshall transcribed everything and put everything together, I then hit everybody up for photos, and I didn't want to use any photos that we'd seen before. That's my big complaint. Like, I go to the bookstore and I see like a new horror book, and it's all the photos that have been used for the last like 90 years. And I'm like, oh God, it's just something new.
Right. Amen.
And so, yeah. So part of the criteria is that we're going to utilize, not use any studio photos the best we can, and utilize people's personal photos from set and from the shop, and just really kind of give a broader look at things, and again, not make it boring. I always find those books are so boring. That
right, you get behind the scenes.
Yeah, yeah.
And Universal, awesome.
Universal Studios keeps putting out the same monster book over and over again. And like, I just saw another one yesterday, and I'm like, I already own this book like 10 times. And it's just like,
yeah, yeah. You get so many of those gift books, don't you?
Yeah.
That you just, that people give you, and you flick through them, and then you put them on your shelf, and yeah, you never look at them again. You certainly never read them. You know, we really wanted to put together a book that people would actually want to read. And so we kind of deliberately made it like lots of fun stuff, not like huge blocks of text, not like this is the exhaustive history, because exhaustive things are just actually more like exhausting things.
Yeah.
You know, we wanted something that, you know, you kind of, that took you all over the place. But by the time you get to the end, you're hopefully being entertained, but also it all sort of sorts itself out in your brain, and you just have all these great stories that you can relate. You know, we just wanted to include all the cream from all the interviews we did. Yeah. So we must have done 140, 150 hours worth of interviews. And really, we were completely brutal about, you know, what we cut and what we left in. And it was like everything had to like pass absolute, you know, muster. Like everything had to be just the best stories from everybody.
Yeah, so, and I think that accompanies the pictures that you guys were just talking about, not having the stock photos, if you will, of just all of these movies that people have seen and heard about, to see it with a fresh set of eyes because of these pictures that they shared. I mean, some of the stuff from like American Werewolf in London, which is one of my favorite movies, seeing the photos and the accounts of John Landis talking about it and the actors talking about it, or Bruce Campbell in Evil Dead. Man, oh man, that stuff is just like nerd out stuff for me personally. It's like the stuff that you hope to find, like when you bought the DVDs back in the day and they would have all that extra commentary, you know, where you would want it, you were just dying to read that. And I feel like this book has that, so much so that you have people talking about it for your afterward, Seth MacFarlane or Guillermo del Toro for the Ford. I mean, they're just, you have like the biggest of the biggest fans and leaders of the industry. Is there one that stands out to you guys where you're like, wow, didn't know that? That one shocked me a little bit.
Well, I think that was part of the fun of this, making this book and interviewing people, because a lot of these people are my friends for decades, and I always felt like I knew so much about them, and I always found something else new that I didn't know, you know. And Kazu, who's an amazing makeup artist, won the Oscar for Darkest Hour for the makeup he did on Gary Oldman, and then won another Oscar for Bombshell, you know, the makeups he did on that movie. And it was really interesting talking to Kazu because he has a different mindset. Like, he didn't grow up as a monster kid, but he loved transformation, you know, transformation of actors into other characters or other sure. people. He's a master at that, truly is. His eye is so trained impeccably. But just hearing his thoughts and how he approaches things and the philosophy he has, you know, because so many of us are like, you know, I grew up loving monsters in my bedroom. I made monsters, you know, destroyed my bedroom. And, you know, it was all about this, this, and this. And Kazu wasn't that. And it probably has to do with growing up in Japan as well.
Sure.
But it was super, super interesting. Just backstepping to American Werewolf, which that's one of my favorite films as well. And getting to talk to, of course, Rick Baker, who created everything and won the first Academy Award for his work in that movie. And John Landis, and you know, Marshall had the really great idea of combining their interviews, so it almost felt like they were in the same room talking about the same subject but different viewpoints, which
exactly how it felt.
Yeah, I think that's hilarious. So one of the things we wanted to ensure that everything that was in the book is correct. So once Marshall wrote everything, we sent everybody their individual sections of the book. You know, these are the quotes we're going to use, and make sure they were good with them. There wasn't anything that we were using that might be questionable, or they didn't want, you know, maybe they said some things that they didn't really end up wanting in the book, or if they wanted to add or take away. And so it was great, you know, this way, you know, everybody is represented properly by themselves. So, you know, sometimes, like with Richard Taylor, who owns Weta Workshop, who did the Lord of the Rings movies and, you know, King Kong, 100 things, he's a genius, like added to his. So it came back with a lot of stuff, which we ended up using all of it because it was from Richard's mouth. And that's also what's cool. This is all from the horse's mouth. So it's not that, you know, it's Marshall and my interpretation of what was being said. This is a you know, a one-on-one conversation. So when you read the book, you know, our hope is that you feel as the reader that those people are speaking directly to you as they were talking to us.
Yeah, I got to say, I feel like, you know, as a journalist, I've done many, many interviews over the years, and it's not always easy to draw people out, even if you have a lot of experience of doing that. And a lot of it comes down to trust. And, you know, increasingly, interviews get shorter and shorter. I mean, I remember, you know, when I started, you could get an hour with somebody. I mean, if they were plugging a movie or something, it gets to the point now where it's all got to be on video. You get 3 minutes.
Yeah.
And you ask two questions and there's somebody standing behind you going like, wrap it up already. So to be able to be in a position where we can interview people for like 2 hours plus was incredible. But also, I would never have been able to get all of those stories out if it had just been me sitting and interviewing them. You know, the fact is that with Howard there, they were catching up with an old friend. And so they were sort of, you know, unguarded and relaxed from the start. We didn't really, you know, get into questions immediately. There was always some chit chat, and which was like absolutely amazing to be a part
sure.
of, by the way. Really enjoyed that.
Like you a know, fly on the wall, huh?
It was amazing. It was just amazing. But they definitely, they weren't just generous with their time and their pictures. They were very generous with their stories and talking about, you know, growing up and stuff, because, you know, they're talking to, you know, Howard, who's a contemporary. They, you know, in many respects, they've kind of grown up together. They've come up through the industry together, or they consider Howard like a mentor. So, this book, in terms of, you know, the way they opened up and also the access, just the access to these people,
yeah,
you know, would never have happened without Howard. So, you know, I mean, it's kind of, that's why it feels so chatty and relaxed, you know,
yeah,
because it was.
Yeah. And getting these stories written down. I mean, some of these people have been in the industry a long time, and Howard, you are no schlup. You are a Oscar winner, and the book you mentioned earlier from the, in the 80s, that was that monster book that changed your life.
Monster.
Yeah, that changed your life. You walked around with it in your backpack, I read, and You took it to different spots in North Hollywood. You know, you begged your mom to go and sit in on like almost like an internship for one of your idols, and you got him autographed. Like, that's what you're doing now for a whole other generation of kids out there that will grow up and to do interviews and hopefully add a part three to this odyssey. That is the first book. That was the one that you talked about. Then you got your book here. What does that mean to you in terms of like setting the bar for the next generation of artists that are coming up?
It's cool. I mean, it's super cool. I'm very excited about it. And, you know, the response we're getting is very overwhelming. You know, we've gotten some, like Marshall said earlier, some really amazing comments from people. And I mean, I feel like we accomplished what we set out to do, and to be able to produce a book of this quality, filled with so many great things, so many great photos, so many great words. It means a lot. And you know, a lot of the makeup schools around the world are reaching out saying, this is going to become part of our curriculum. This is truly the history. You know, this is a giant history lesson. We need our students to learn. And that's wonderful. I mean, it's wonderful that we're selling those books, but it's also really wonderful. Sure. That, you know, it's bestowing a certain amount of very candid lessons. You know, that was the other thing too. Marshall and I knew we did not want to do a how-to book. I feel there's already enough of those. I wasn't about to talk about how you apply makeup or how you color theory or how you mix blood. It wasn't interesting to me, but I love stories. I always have. I'm a storyteller. You know, Marshall's a storyteller. And in my mind, that's how people live on and on and on. That's how history,
it's your legacy. Yeah,
it is. And I think it's great. And you know, of course, you know, there's a lot of people we didn't get to interview, and we were on a very short time frame to write this book, even though it's 2 years, but 2 years goes very, very quickly. So we allowed ourselves like 4 months to interview people. We were able to do 2 interviews a week at the most, just because it was a lot of work to
prep, sure,
and then do it all, and then Marshall to figure out everything, and then once we had what we felt was enough information, we reached out to publishers, and we reached out to a lot of publishers. And I actually went to a bookstore, a Barnes & Noble bookstore in the San Fernando Valley. It's called Bookstar. It's in Studio City. And my wife and I went to the movie section, and we looked at all the publishers who had books. So wrote down, we found out.
It's like old school. I like it.
Yeah, this is how we did it. And we wrote down and found their contact, and then Marshall put together a great pitch, and we sent it out to everyone. And out of, you know, I don't know, maybe 20, 30 publishers, you know, there were like 2 or 3 that bit, and then we ended up picking the one we felt most comfortable with, which was Wellback Publishing. And the fun thing was, yesterday I went to that bookstore and my book was there on that shelf. I sent a photo to Marshall.
That was that original bookshelf.
That's the bookstore that we found all the publishers, and Miriam and I went 2 years ago and took a look to see what was there. And that was her idea, by the way. She's like, let's go to a bookstore. And
Howard did the most classic author thing that you do. You go into the bookshop, you find your book, you take it out, and you put it flat so that it's facing everybody and covering everyone else's books. Right. That is the most classic author move. So when he sent me that, I thought, that is, your journey is now complete.
Oh, yeah. No, right. It was really fun. That was the full circle. And what was great is they couldn't find the book, because first they said, oh, well, we got a bunch in, but they might all be sold out. So I was happy about that. And then they're like, oh, no, there's one over here. And I walked down there and I was like, this is great. So yes, I took it out. It was next to a Friday the 13th book, and I just put it flat. And I'm like, all right, there you go. And but the guy at the store was like, oh, yeah, we got to order more. Those like flew off the shelf. So we're ordering more in. And I'm like, that sounds great. He's like, do you want me to order you one? I'm like, no, I was just curious. I was walking past, and, you know, my wife, Miriam's like, you should tell him you wrote it. I'm like, that's not what this is about. I just wanted to see my book in a bookstore that I go to all the time. So it's very thrilling and lovely. And so, but yeah, we want to do another volume. I mean, we're going to try to get the publisher to agree, because we're ready to go. I'm ready to go start writing now. I know Marshall is ready to go as well. And we've already created our list of people that we're going to talk to. And I think now that we have a successful book, because it has sold out in the United States completely, and they're starting their second.
Congratulations.
Thank you. They're starting their second edition. And then it's going to be translated into Japanese and Chinese. But Marshall and I are excited if it gets into Swahili so we can see what our name looks like in Swahili. Right.
We want all the languages.
All of them. We want our names in all the languages.
I imagine a little bit of vindication as well for both of you, only for the sense of when you talk about a project in the beginning stages of it, and there are sure some people who are always skeptics, right? They're always like, I don't know if anybody needs that or blah, blah, blah. And you're like, nah, stick it up your, you know what? Because I'm going to do this because I want to do it. And I don't really care if anybody else likes it. I know it's going to be good, and I'm going to do it for my own satisfaction. Or the two of you did this together because this is something that you really felt that that you wanted to tell for your own satisfaction. And to the fact that people are responding to it in a positive way is just got to be gratifying, because it's like, I knew it. I knew this was great. And we are doing something good just for our industry, for our profession, because these stories wouldn't have been told in this manner otherwise. And now it is. And that's something great. You put something out into the world.
You're absolutely right. And I got to say, when we were pitching it, if anybody sort of knocked us back and said, oh, we're not, you know, because everybody was so damn nervous during the pandemic to do anything, to commit any money to anything, or to just get anything started. And so if anybody said, oh, you know, we're not sure, I won't tell you what publishers, but some people said, oh, you know, we're not sure about, you know, it might be difficult getting the rights to some of the pictures, or, you know, it's like, it's like, what are you talking about? This right. is the best book ever. What are you talking about? This is like Howard. This is like Rick Baker and Tom Savini. This is Bruce Campbell and Robert Englund. This is Guillermo del Toro. And like, what are you talking about? Why are you even questioning it? Why aren't you just driving a truck of money to our house and saying,
right. I don't understand. Well, you guys said there was only two publishers that seemed interested out of the however many you talked to. I was like,
people were just terrified. People were just terrified to commit to it. Fools.
And publishers that, you know, their bread and butter is movie books, you know, like Titan. If you go to a bookstore, it's Titan on all the movie books. And it was just so weird. I'm like, this is the perfect Titan book. But they like to focus more on like the book of Alien, the book of Avatar, sure. the book of so one subject. And they couldn't really see how this would work. I mean, our publishers who you know, took the chance, but we didn't think it was much of a chance because we knew what we were making. They had never done anything like this before. They're, I think, primarily in sports and a bunch of other things. So they really rolled the dice, which we really greatly appreciated. And we had a great editor with us and a designer. But, you know, they completely underestimated the sales, which I love. You know, they should have doubled the first edition, and they didn't. It sold out. It actually sold out 4 weeks prior to it being released.
Just in pre-order.
Just pre-orders sold
out. That's incredible. That doesn't happen very much anymore.
They said it never has happened to them ever. So I was very pleased about that, with the exception of the supply chain being disrupted and people were waiting too long to get their books. And then in the UK, it's doing very well, but not like in the United States. The United States, it just killed. But hopefully we'll pick up more momentum as we have events in the UK. And, you know, it's great. You know, you go on it on social media and you see somebody in Italy talking about the book, holding it up, or Spain, or, you know, even a girl in the Ukraine got the book. There was somebody that came to our first signing and said, this is for a makeup artist in the Ukraine, got the book to her. And she posted that this has been a saving grace for her to have the book during this time of war in the Ukraine. And I'm like, that's crazy. Like a book about monster making. but it's really super cool. And you know, we want to perpetuate what we do and show the love. And you know, there's a ton of people out there that love monsters, movies, horror films, and just movies. You know, I'm always surprised when I'm on a film and I'm talking to an actor and they'll say, I wanted to be a makeup effects artist, but I decided to become an actor. And like some really, really big A-list actors say that. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, really? You know? And they're like, oh yeah, I love it. I really wanted to do this, but I just wasn't sure how, but I knew I could be an actor. And I'm like, well, I think the acting thing worked out pretty well for you. So
yeah, I gotta say, just I found the book by social media. I was going on Instagram and I saw Robert Englund posted a picture of it. Yeah. And I was like, Robert Englund's posting a picture about a book that I haven't heard of just yet. I need to know all about it. And Howard, I think I blasted your inbox there on Instagram, but it just proves once again that social media is not all evil and terrible, that it can be used for good things, because we found the way to connect. And I'm just very grateful for both of you for the time that you did in writing the book. I feel like I kind of accustomed to, when I was a kid, my first ever look into like Fangoria magazine, because it was like the only thing that I could find that was horror movies. And I looked at it and I was like, oh, this is amazing. This book gives me that all over again. It gives me that feeling of being a kid all over again and have an appreciation as an adult to look through it, from movies from when I was a kid, prior to me even being born, to movies through now, and to hear it and see it through both of your lenses, Howard and Marshall, is incredible. And like a real privilege, just because the work that you've done, Howard and Marshall, it's just incredible that you were able to gather all these people and to put them all in one room, so to speak, and put it out on this book. Congratulations to the both of you. It's an amazing book.
Thank you.
And please come and be our publicist. That was very good. That was very, very good. It's like,
no problem. Yeah, for sure. For free. I don't want to charge anything to talk to you guys. You guys are wonderful. One more time again, for people to find access to the book, what's the best way they want to buy it or get in the pre-order line to get it?
So just go to www.mastersofmakeupeffects.net. You can find our t-shirts there. You can find links to all the online booksellers in the UK and the US selling and stocking the book, or just go into your local bookshop. I mean, they seem to be popping up there now, but you've got to be quick because they seem to be selling now. And we put everything in one place, so it's easy. So we only ever have to, you know, share one link, just mastersofmakeupeffects.net.
Yeah, it's that easy.
And is there
any social media that you guys want people to follow, or is it the same?
I'm on Instagram, so it's hoops511, so HOOPS 511, and I'm always posting something of interest. And then Marshall's got his social medias.
On Twitter, just at Marshall Julius. Yeah, you know, yesterday I posted a picture of a cannoli, the Italian, you know, sweet treat, with a little cape on it, and I put Obi-Wan Cannoli, and it got 70,000 likes.
Wow!
It's like, are you joking? Honestly, that wasn't even like my gag. I just found it. Sometimes I create my own stuff. Other times I sort of just like, oh yeah, I'll nick that. And and it's like, you know, it's like, what about my, you know, Guillermo del Toro birthday post with him holding a copy of our book? That should get 70,000.
Yeah, no kidding.
Likes, you know, that is sort of a miracle. Honestly, when I saw Rick Baker holding a copy of our book, like pressed it up to his face, when I saw Tom Savini posting, looking at the book like that. Yeah. Tom Savini was looking at that book and it was like, hey guys, you know, get a room, okay? I mean, he was just like, he was just really into it. And it's like, this is just like, blows my mind, you know? So yeah, social media isn't this cesspit from my point of view. We don't get political, we don't get trolly, you know. I think Howard and my, our social is just full of sort of love for what we do, and you know, just kind of fun. And so I think people have responded to it. And look, the fact that you discovered the stuff that we're doing, the book through that, I mean, it obviously works.
Yeah. Well, thank you both very much for joining me. And I cannot wait until the second volume comes out. I know you're probably like, Oh, we're so tired. We're done with the first one, but
no, we're excited to do it, but you are going to have to wait a little while.
Yeah, you got to write it first, right? And do the interviews, do the work. That's the thing that a lot of people don't remember is that there's actually work involved, that you need to do this hard work to have this incredible payoff. But you guys have done that with this first volume, Masters of the Makeup Effects. Thank you, gentlemen, both for joining me today. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Tom.
Thank you.